Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome to episode 263, I think, of the Spearhead Sundays podcast. I'm your host, Lewis Spears, and I need to apologize for what I've done. I'm getting cancelled at the moment. I'm in big trouble. You probably would have seen the news. It's a huge controversy. It's actually happening, you know, all across the world. This thing that I've done, it's actually inspired others, and it's gone incredibly viral, and I just needed to address the controversy. I needed to apologize because obviously you guys might have seen the news article about the guy that surrendered his dog to a shelter because they thought the dog was gay. I just wanted to come out there and say, I'm sorry. I just don't want a gay dog. You know, I just didn't want a gay dog. I really tried, but fuck, man, the struggles of having a gay dog, it's really tough. Man, you guys wouldn't know with all of you straight dogs out there. I mean, fuck, even having a trans dog is easier than having a gay dog. You know, I'd wake up every morning, he'd fucking rip his way into a packet of glitter. All he would do is just hang around my girlfriend and they'd both bitch about me, right? He would get into my fucking shoes and instead of like chewing on them, he'd try them on. Every time I came out of the bedroom wearing an outfit he didn't like, he would destroy my clothes. I'm sick of it. I don't want a gay dog. All right? And yes, you can tell. Okay, obviously that wasn't me. I love my dog and she's a girl. I'm pretty sure I do have a dyke dog, though. I wouldn't be surprised if my dog Bobby was a lesbian. You know? My dog has been mistaken for a boy so many times that I reckon I'm just going to give up. And it doesn't help that I've given her a male name either. Everyone thinks my dog is a boy because it looks like it's going to bite your face. You know, it's like a terrifying looking dog. I've got a lesbian dog. I think it's fine. You know, I've got a butch lesbian dog. If my dog had a choice in what she wore, she would 100% be wearing denim vests. Because that's about the gayest thing that a woman can wear on earth. We've established this many episodes ago. This is established Spearhead Sunday's lore. There's nothing gayer than a denim vest on a woman. You ever see a chick in a denim vest? She eats pussy like it's breakfast. Ferociously. All right? Tell me about this. We got this news article here. A person actually surrendered a dog for being gay. What's the headline?
Yeah, so the headline is dog...
By the way, Keelan's sick, so he sounds a little bit different.
Dog allegedly abandoned at shelter after owners decided he was gay.
That's so homophobic. I can't believe how homophobic that is. That put that guy in the homophobe Olympics, I think. That's, imagine hating gay so much that you can't even let a dog be gay around you. You know, like if you really think your dog's gay and you really hate the idea of them being gay, I mean, if it's de-sexed, I mean, aren't all dogs incels anyway? Like most dogs and cats are non-binary, if we're being honest. You know, you fucking de-sex them and they're walking around. They don't want to fuck. They don't really know what gender they are. And then you remove all of their instincts around sex. They're kind of walking around like non-binary they-thems, you know? They've all got short hair. Like, that's about as fucking non-binary as you can get. All right? So I don't understand the problem with having a gay dog. I've got one. It's great. How did they know the dog was gay?
Well, they didn't. They apparently they decided he was gay because he humped another male dog.
But that shit happens all the time. See, that's like a strict policy, like a one hump policy. You're out of here. I reckon that dog is. I think the gay thing is like an excuse. I think that dog was just like a shit dog. You know, and like the gay thing was like the straw that broke the camel's back. That like, not only are you annoying to walk, you pull on the lead, you don't listen to me, you don't know how to shake or sit or lie down. You're also gay. That's it. Get in the pound. Which I think for a gay dog is like a bit of a utopia. You know, like there's nothing. There's like in terms of it. Look, I'm saying is if I had a choice, if I'm going to prison. And I could change my, if like before I went into prison, I could hit a little button that would change my sexuality. You know, I'm slapping the gay button, you know, like 100%. I'm smashing that make me gay button. right before I go in and smash my fellow inmates. I feel like if you had a choice in your sexuality, being gay in prison has got to be better than being straight in prison. Maybe it depends on the prison. Depends how progressive your prison is, you know? Like, you don't want to be gay in one of those Russian prisons. No. You don't want to be in one of those Russian prisons at all, actually. But I feel like being, you know, like if you were gay in a Texan prison, that's not fun. But if you were gay in like a Californian prison, that's like utopia, you know? Like, because not only can you fuck your inmates and enjoy it, you also get things like meals. I think they get, as opposed to in Texas prisons, they don't get meals. But yeah, look. So the update with his dog, did the pound have anything to say about that? Like, because it's not like here's the hard thing with the pound is the guy showed up and was like, I want to surrender my dog because it's gay. And the pound didn't go, that's not a legitimate reason to surrender the dog. They took it. They were like, okay, understandable. So I think the real story is what's going on with this homophobic pound? What's going on with this anti-gay pound where this guy shows up and goes, I would like to surrender my dog, it's fucking gay. And instead of them going, well, actually, you know, not only does it not matter if a dog is gay, because it's de-sexed anyway, so it doesn't matter. Also, why you could just like keep it away from other dogs so it doesn't have sex with them. Also, it's a dog being gay isn't a problem, even if they could be gay, which we're all on the fence about anyway, right? I feel like those things should have been said, but they weren't. Instead, they were like, oh, a gay dog, disgusting. Put it on death row. Understandable. So what's happened to this dog?
So,
Keelan.
The pound didn't respond to comment, but... It's been revealed.
See, they didn't respond to comment. It's a homophobic pound.
But they did. They did adopt the dog.
Oh, they adopted it out. Okay, yeah. That's good.
And they renamed the dog Oscar.
That's a gay name.
After Oscar Wilde, who is gay.
That's I fucking knew it. I didn't even know that. How did I know that shit? Oscar, gay name. famous gay character on Sesame Street. Oscar the Grouch. Right? Living in a trash can, fucking blokes in an alleyway. That's Oscar. For sure. I mean, that's why it was probably... When was Sesame Street invented? It's an old show, right? The guy was probably homeless because he was gay.
Would have been years ago.
Yeah, it's during homophobic times. It's definitely a gay name. So the dog's been adopted by who?
By a couple.
Did anyone like... Because here's the thing. I reckon that surrendering a dog for being gay is fuck, but like I want the gay dog is like also strange, you know?
Well, the couple, their names are Steve and John.
Oh, okay. So. All right. So they wanted a gay dog.
Yeah.
How inclusive. That's kind of interesting where it's like, I also want my dog to be gay. Why is that? You know, what's all that about? You know, just two gay blokes and then one gay dog just hanging out, chilling. Personally, I don't care about my dog's sexuality and I think those two blokes should be investigated. Because why would you specifically want a gay dog? You know? Nah, all good. Guys, come see me live. LoosePears.com. My shows start next week. Melbourne. This might be the only shows that I do all year because I got amazing surgeries that'll change my face and how I sound permanently. That I may not survive. So LoosePears.com, they might be the final shows I ever do in my life. They're happening next Friday and Saturday are the first two shows. And then from then it is Friday, Saturday. We've got six shows on. It's going to be sick. Tickets are now moving. They're going quick now, so they've really picked up. So grab your tickets now, LoosePears.com. Also, the Straight Outta Frankston merch drop just went live. The shirts and the hoodies and the stickers are fire. I want you to see them. Keelan and I, we went out and we shot the Straight Outta Frankston video, didn't we, mate?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was pretty good. It was real fun. One thing that didn't make it to air is, and we talked about this on the Luke and Lewis podcast, but I might as well say it again here. We came across... three 2 liter bottles of day old piss on the ground in Frankston. And we passed it. I made a few jokes about it, ended up cutting them from the video because it was just fucking gross. And then we came back and on the way back, Keelan runs up to the bottle of piss And I say, no, what are you doing? Stop, don't touch it. He picks it up and he just flings it in a direction, not looking where he's going. This all happened, by the way. Just flings it. And then I watch this bottle arc beautifully in the air, just like horrified as the bottle goes up, starts to come down. And then, you know who walked into my peripheral vision? A woman, a bystander, just walking directly into the path of this floating, majestic bottle of homeless piss. And then it smashes on the ground in front of her, definitely soaks her shoes. And I think one of the funniest things I've ever heard in my life is Keelan profusely apologizing between 6 to 10 times in a row as the bottle was in the air before it hit the woman, because he knew it was going to happen. So the reason why he sounds weird is because the cops bashed him and he's just gotten out of prison. But yeah, so look, that was fun. Check out that video and grab your tickets, man. I'm really excited for these shows. I really want to make the most of it. They're in big theaters. They're going to be fun. Yeah, they're probably going to be the last shows that I do for many months. So I'm really going to like soak it up, enjoy it, and make a real good time of it. We had the Luke Lewis and Friends show just last night for me, and patrons, if you listen to this early when it comes out. And man, it was awesome. Thanks so much to everyone who came out. It was like the last kind of big show I've gotten to do before my festival. And I was like just testing new material. And man, I went great, which is good because it was like the last 20 minutes of material that I've kind of been unsure about. Like, I'm like, oh, is this done? Does it need more work? And I did it, and it all smashed, which is amazing. Got some really great feedback. So now I'm like, oh yeah, the show's definitely fucking killer. It's going to be really good. So it just needs like a few little more tweaks and some changing of things. And I'm really excited about these shows, man. I think they're going to be really fun, and I can't wait to meet everyone afterwards. And I'm just gonna really enjoy it. You know, there's kind of like two ways to look at it. Either it's going to be, oh fuck, this is kind of sad, it's going to be the last few shows I get to do. Or I can look at it as like, man, how lucky am I to do, you know, 6 amazing shows during the comedy festival right before someone cuts my face in half and moves molds my skull to, dude, I have been, my sleep apnea has gotten so fucking bad. You've seen this, Keelan. I this week I have fallen asleep during the day 3 times. Three days. And yesterday it was like multiple times in a day, just falling asleep, you know. Keelan and Rosie go on lunch and then I just fall asleep. And they come back and they go, are you asleep? And I go, fuck, was I? You know, Keelan drives me to the Luke Lewis and Friends show. I fall asleep in the car. And then I think I fell asleep at the venue before the show. And then I think I also fell asleep at some other point during that day. It's gotten so fucking bad. I am just not sleeping anymore. What happens is that is I make it to about 10 p.m. I close my eyes, and then at 7 a.m. my alarm goes off, and then I stop it from making noise, and then I actually get out of bed at around 8:30. And in between those times, I wasn't conscious, but I certainly wasn't sleeping. I was in there fighting for my fucking life, just absolutely battling, trying to keep my tongue from covering my throat so I can actually get some fucking air in, you know? Dude, every night, I feel like Riley Reid mid-scene, you know? Just, I need to breathe, but I can't. And it's affecting my brain power. I don't know. I can't take much more of this, and that's why I'm getting my surgery done. But it's like ramping up and progressively getting worse and worse to the point where, yeah, I'm just falling asleep during the day. So I've now, my sleep apnea has gotten so bad that I'm now at the point where I'm fucking stoked. I cannot wait for this painful recovery process just so I can have like one dream. Like, man, I wonder what my first dream's going to be. I'm going to have like 3 years of pent up dreams just in my brain. It's just going to come out. I'm going to do like a 3-hour long podcast just describing my first dream. Man, I'll put the fucking house on it. I bet it's just going to be like a dream where I just, you know, one of those dreams where you have a full on conversation with someone, but like it's all gibberish and it makes no sense. And you wake up and you're like, man, I feel like I understand my friends now. Like, it's going to be one of those, like, pointless ones that you can't explain, but I will try to for 3 hours. little update on the Patreon. So on a couple episodes ago, I announced a new little chat in the Patreon Discord called Cafe Shaming, where all of the patrons and all the listeners of the show, if you're a Patreon supporter, can head in there and just absolutely publicly shame any cafe that is acting ridiculous. And we've got this one. We've got this one here from the... Okay, the guy has a Russian name, so I don't know what the fuck we're going to call him. But yeah, look, Russian name guy. Okay, so Vlad. I'm just going to call him Vlad. Sorry, but also stay out of Ukraine. All right. So he said the food was good at this cafe, but what's this cafe called? Home Coffee, Sydney. Home Coffee, Sydney, you're on notice. All right? Stop this right now. Home Coffee, Sydney is serving coffee in water glasses. Stop that right now. I don't want to drink a coffee out of a fucking water glass, all right? That's obscene. That's ridiculous. It's not how you should be serving coffee. They get hot. You feel strange. You ever drink something out of a container that normally holds something else? Have you ever had, even if it's completely clean, it tastes like that other thing? I remember I used to do a comedy bit where I would drink blue Gatorade out of a Windex bottle. It was like one of my first ever gags that I came up with. It was kind of a hack and whatever. It was one of the first gags I ever did, and I washed it out so many times, but it still tasted like Windex. Now, upon telling that story, I now realize that maybe that's because I didn't wash it as thoroughly as I should have, and that's a bad example, and I was just drinking Windex, and maybe that's why I'm the way I am today, all right? But what I'm saying is, have you ever drank like water out of a milk bottle that's been cleaned many times? It still tastes like milk, and it's just because you know that milk was in there. Like, I don't want my cappuccino to taste like water, you know? Like, how fucking strange is it to drink water out of a tea glass or a coffee cup? It's there's something wrong with it. Like, doing it the other way around is almost worse. Like, are they doing that? Are they serving fucking water in tea glasses? Because that'd be absolutely chaotic. Actually, I would respect that more, is if you order a coffee or a water and they come out with both of them and like the liquids are just switched in different containers, that would just like, I reckon I would have to flip the table and leave. I would have an aneurysm. So Home Coffee Sydney, fix your shit. If you want to submit more cafe shaming, sign up to the Patreon, join the cafe shaming chat, and keep it on topic. Sweet. So you also get access to full uncut episodes of the podcast. I do an extra half hour every single week, and there's heaps of benefits, early access to videos, free merch, heaps of stuff. Patreon.com/loosebeers. Check it out. A little bit about me, my week. I ate raw meat for the first time. Now, going into it, I ate raw kangaroo mince straight out of the packet. That wasn't fake. Didn't fake it at all. I opened the packet and I took like two giant bites out of the mince, straight in, blood and everything, right? Now, I was thinking that I would vomit. Like, I'm like, I'm going to spew. Like, this is I'm going to spew. It's going to make me feel sick. I did it on a day where I didn't have too many important shows afterwards that I could probably cancel if I felt terrible. I was just like, you know what? I'll get all my important work done at the start of the week because I'm going to eat fucking raw mince and then I'm going to feel very sick. And man, I'm not lying to you when I say this. It was fucking delicious. It was really nice. And I think that I'm like, no one's more surprised than I am. I'm so shocked. I took a bite of that mince and my brain was like, you're going to vomit. And my taste buds were like, this is amazing. This is really nice. And everyone around me, if you watch the Liver King video, everyone around me is vomiting. Keelan's vomiting, weren't you?
Not good.
Zach was vomiting, weren't you?
Not good at all.
But everyone other than me and Rosie were just maniacally laughing. So there's something wrong with her as well. Right? But it was honestly, man, it was fucking nice. Like, I would actually, literally, have it again. The egg wasn't gross, it just wasn't nice. The mince was good. And that terrifies me. That makes me really upset with the type of person that I am. But also, there was an undeniable feeling of power. When I took a bite into that raw mince and it tasted good, I was like, I'm a fucking alpha male. And now I get it. Now I get all those raw meat freaks. I don't think it's about the diet. I think it's about freaking other people out. There was something exhilarating about eating something that made other people vomit in front of you. That feeling was good. And I would love to be able to bust that one out at lunchtime, you know? What are you having for lunch? I've got a sandwich. What are you having for lunch? I've got a salad. And then I pull out like a slab of, like a 1 kilo slab of kangaroo mince, just start biting into it in public. Everyone starts vomiting while I'm just like fine and alpha. That's amazing. Made me feel good. But you know, after that, I was like, okay, cool. I'm going to be very sick. You know, because I had a lot. I had like two big mouthfuls of raw mince. I'd never eaten it before. So like even if I wouldn't get sick normally, my stomach's not used to that. I had a raw egg. But I was fine. I was absolutely fine. I felt it in me. You know when you eat something new and you can just feel it in there? I've had that feeling, but it wasn't bad. My body was like, what's this, champ? What have you done here? All right, we better send in some extra workers to sort that one out. But honestly, I felt completely fine. The straight after, hours after, the next day, on the toilet, fine. I did one heinous fart. One. That was it. And I remember it. I was in public. And you know it's real bad. Dude, if you fart while you're walking and you can still smell it in public when it's windy, that's a bad one. You know, like, thank God I didn't do that shit in the shower. I would have passed out. You know, if I did that in an elevator, I could have killed someone. But luckily, I did it in public walking while it was windy. Still smelled it. That's a problem. So I'm glad that I got like the watered down version of that sarin gas fart. Like, thank God, you know, you thought the fucking refugees escaping Ukraine had a brush with death. Try ripping one of those farts in the shower. All right. And then come talk to me about war crimes. All right, I want to talk about the Ace family, their music festival. The Ace family vloggers, right? Austin Jones, is that the guy's name? Or is that someone else? No, Austin McBroom. Austin Jones is like some... Can you Google Austin Jones? Is that a pedophile that I've just referenced off the top of my head? Who's Austin Jones?
Austin Jones is a musician and convicted sex offender.
Hey, Wikipedia, switch those two. How about switch those two? You know, don't put musician first. Sex offender and musician. Thank you very much. Austin McBroom, not a pedophile. I'll get that on record. So far, as we know, you know, as we know anyway. So what is this festival? They've started a festival, and if you buy tickets, there's this controversial family vlogging thing, and they have a festival, and if you buy tickets to it, you can win tickets to their wedding. What? That's going to be the worst VIP experience of all time. Could you imagine having fans at your fucking wedding? That's weird. That's so strange. I don't feel like the fans would like that. I don't want... Look, you guys are great. Stay the fuck away from my wedding, you know? I don't think any of you guys are weird. That's a lie. Some of you guys are strange. But for the most part, I have lovely experiences before shows. I love meeting people on the street. I love talking to people. I love reading comments. I see emails come in. I love reading. It's all very positive and nice. Stay the fuck away from personal engagements, all right? If I see any of you cunts at a birthday or a wedding, see ya. Weird. That's awkward. I don't want that. You don't want that. Well, you want to see me on the happiest day of my life? No, you don't. You want to see me on stage screaming. So what's this festival? Why are they organizing a festival? They're not musicians. They're not event organizers. They're a family vlogger. What the fuck's the festival? Come and watch me shop with my toddlers?
It's basically just an event where you can interact with all of the other Ace family members.
Oh, so my joke is actually what it is. That's fucking... That sounds real familiar. So you can buy a ticket to hang around someone else's kid. That sounds familiar. What's that called? Sex trafficking? Isn't that already a big industry? I'm not implying that you can buy a ticket and fuck their kids. That's not on. I hope that's not on.
No, it doesn't say.
So what's, but what is it? You buy a ticket and who the fuck? Who the fuck is buying tickets to hang out with someone else's kids? Put them on a watch list. How much are the tickets?
$500.
$500? That's trafficking. Dude, if I'm buying a ticket to see a kid, I will want it to be cheap, because if it's expensive, I'm going to go, this is going to put me on a watch list, you know? Do they explain the event? Are there like performances or like, it's called Ace Fest.
They'll have, yeah, wildlife animals, live performers, free rides, games, prizes, a wildlife park.
So it's like a fair.
Almost, yeah.
Or a fete. But like,
for this whole family.
But like, is it for kids? Who's?
Oh, it says all ages.
So it's all ages. Right. But the tickets are $300. So like what parent has $300 to send their kid to something? What's this? $299 Ace Fest Pass. What do you get?
So one pass counts as three tickets. You get access to the fest and an autographed poster.
Right. Dude, I need to up my prices. You can see me for $40 and you can get a poster.
It's $299.
American, that's like $400. What am I doing? What the fuck am I doing? is that the cheap ticket or is that the expensive one, Keelan?
It looks like it's the only one. Oh, here we go. There's $299.
Okay.
Then there's $499.
$499 Ace VIP pass. Yeah. What am I getting?
Well, you get to watch Austin's next fight for free.
Okay.
VIP pass.
I mean, that's worth a bit of money. What, like seeing the guy who ripped you off getting punched in the head, you know? But that's bullshit. That's not what I'm buying. Like, you can't sell me a ticket and then go, with this ticket, you get a ticket as something else. That's not a selling point, you know? That's like me selling, hey guys, come and see me in Melbourne. With every ticket, you get to see me in Perth. Like, that doesn't... Like, but doing an unrelated thing. Like, if you buy a ticket to my comedy show, I'll give you a ticket to me doing a go-kart race in a different place that you can't get to. That's not a sell. What else do I get with my VIP pass?
You get an exclusive wedding gift.
Huh?
I don't know. It just
wait. So they're getting
the wedding gift.
Okay, yeah, but it's not a gift because I'm giving you $500.
Yeah,
Austin Jones. Is that it?
That's it, yeah.
That's the only difference between these two.
You also get a guaranteed meet and greet.
Okay.
And yeah, tickets to a fight and a wedding gift.
And I get to meet his kids.
Yeah.
Dude, that's so fucking weird. How old are his kids?
Oh, they look young. They look pretty young.
Yeah, they're young, right? That's so fucking weird.
They're like five. They're not even five.
That's strange, man. Charging strangers to meet your kids. You don't know this. That's fucking, that's like another level of monetizing your children. Already family vloggers are like very suspect for like monetizing their children's development and like turning every life event into a video. It like encourages the kids to like be performative even when they're at their most emotional moments. It makes it seem like less real. But then like, I don't know. I just couldn't imagine like as a father going, all right, honey, up, get out of bed. It's time to meet strangers who have paid a lot of money to meet you. That's weird, bro. Yeah, and you get to meet the kids. It's not Austin. You get to meet the kids.
Yeah.
That's weird. That's fucking, that's,
doesn't sound good to me.
That's so weird. That's like even like, oh, come and meet some other kids who have paid to meet you. Like, that's so strange, man. Yeah. And where is this? Like, what's the capacity of this event? Like, is it at a venue? Is it just on a patch of grass?
It sounds like it's going to be... Oh, here we go. Tickets go on sale April 9th. That's when they release the location. They haven't even said the location yet.
Yeah, this is not an event.
They haven't even released the actual date of the event.
Right, this is a fucking cash grab, dude. This might as well be a fucking NFT, you know? Like, oh, if you buy this, you get a bunch of things that aren't actually things, and then you get to join the community, and we might have a meetup at some point. Thanks for your money. Like, it's a fucking NFT, if we're being honest. Which I would actually respect more if they just sold fucking NFTs. You know? That's Ace Fest.
No date, no venue.
So it's just a fate and you might get to meet one of his kids. That's so fucking weird. man, like this is the shit that as an actual performer who puts so much effort into like fucking writing a good show and picking nice venues and making tickets as affordable as they can be and like really trying to like make my shows as good as they can be for the people there, not just for my bank account. It shits me so much to see like other influencers doing cash grab events, because often, understandably so, people just look at anyone with an online following doing an event going, oh, that's going to be fucking shithouse, because every single one I've heard about is, yeah, I don't know, man. I don't know about like just doing events because you can. There's so many of those around now where it's like, oh, I have an online following, I can do an event, maybe I should just sell tickets to something, and it turns out it's like some fucking event where you're just there and people are like, they get to meet you and that's like the only thing you get. Like, fuck that, dude. You know, my shit is like, I'm going to give you a show and then you can also meet me if you would like. Like, I would never want to be like, oh, you get to meet me and that's it. That's all you get. 30 seconds with me. Like, hey, thanks, you want a photo? Right, fuck off, next. Although I should do that. It would make me a lot more money. So the US, right, before I get into miscellaneous bit at the end, before we do that, this episode is sponsored by manscaped.com, guys. Use code SPEARS for 20% off and free shipping, the best ball bag trimmer in the game, all right? Manscaped.com, they have some of the best personal groomers on the market, something that I use all the time, down there and on my face, because I'm no coward, all right? Absolutely, I double it up. They also have a bunch of really cool personal grooming products. They've got chapstick, which is actually really nice. They've got body wash. They've got 2-in-1 shampoo and conditioner, and there's nothing funny about that. Look, mainly, dude, they got ball toner, all right? You can just slather something called ball toner all over your nuts, and to be honest, when I saw that, I thought it was bullshit. I laughed at it. Put it on my nuts. Kind of nice. Like, what do you want from me? It's kind of nice. And I don't say shit is nice unless I think it's nice. I say things like, there's nothing funny about that. I think that the ball toner is nice. Feels good, man. When's the last time you treated your nuts to something special, huh? They don't get much. Often they get ignored. And I think that it's time to admit that your balls are neglected. Give them a trim. Give them a tone. All right? Manscaped.com. Use code SPEARS for 20% off and free shipping. For real, the trimmer is great. Okay? It's never cut me. I used the old model, never had an issue. I used the new model now, never had an issue. It's great, okay? They also have guards, so you can change your length. You have your preferred length. You can go, you know, close to the bone, if you know what I mean, or you can be a little bit more natural. It's all good. And they're actually really good for beard, right? Because I've managed to shape my fucking facial hair, which I've never been able to do. Like, if you look at my videos, it's either too short or way too long. I feel like I've got it nice now. And that's because of Manscaped. Manscaped.com, use code SPEARS, 20% off and free shipping. The USA, this is awesome. The United States government, the United States of America, the government is briefing TikTok influencers about the Russia-Ukraine conflict. Can we stop calling things conflicts, please? The conflict. A conflict is like when I have an argument with my mum. That's a conflict, you know? You accidentally push in line in front of someone and they have a crack at you. That's a conflict. When one of the biggest nations in Russia invades... When one of the biggest nations in Europe invade one of the biggest nations in Europe, it's a little bit more than a conflict. I would call that a war, right? An invasion. Let's call it that. But anyway, right? The United States of America is briefing TikTok influencers about the conflict because they want to control misinformation, is what they're saying. Now, a lot of people have come out and gone, oh, why are they briefing TikTok influencers? That app is for dancing. That's a boomer take, okay? The TikTok is not just an app for fucking dancing. It's actually a sick app for whatever you want and whatever you enjoy. And I would say that if the only thing you see when you log on TikTok is underage girls shaking their tits, that's because that's what you interact with and that's what you watch when you open up TikTok. Me, I get like news, I get tech info. I get comedy clips. I get overage girls shaking their tits. And I get cool dog videos. TikTok's great. It's a fucking good app. There's a reason why it's blowing up. And that's because of all my videos. Follow me. But no, there's like genuinely some sick like news, pop culture, tech, like influencers on there that just cover news in like a minute. There are some shit ones, obviously, as well, because, you know, it's social media, so anyone who has who can upload something can have a platform. But yeah, the United States has decided to brief TikTok influencers about the war to give them the truth of the situation. Now, what that means, right, is America's version of the truth. Now, I'm not saying that they'd be lying to these influencers. Well, I am saying that. They're definitely going to be lying to these influencers, but that's not to say that everything they'll say. It's just going to be like a, just about the most West America biased news source you can have is obviously straight from the horse's mouth, you know? Like, let's be real. America is a different country to Ukraine and Russia. They're enemies with Russia, and they're very pro-Ukraine because Russia doesn't like that. Like, that's... So they don't have the truth, you know? They have a very, very biased version of what they would like the truth to be, which is definitely going to be closer to the truth than Russia's version, but that doesn't mean that it is true, right? Obviously, the invasion is heinous and terrible and all this kind of shit, but, you know, I just feel like the government of, you know, the news source being the government of a country that has done literally done exactly what Russia has done to a bunch of Middle Eastern countries is not going to be the best fucking news source, you know? Basically, America has sat down a bunch of fucking TikTok whores and gone, hey, it's fine when we do it, but when they do it, it's fucked. That's, you know, that's the reason, right? Also, the reason that oil price has gone up has nothing to do with inflation. It's all to do with Russia, and it also has nothing to do with us pulling out of Afghanistan, all right? Sweet. Also, nothing to do with us stopping fracking. It's all Russia's fault. Thank you very much. Paying heaps for petrol is a patriotic deed. Thank you. All right? Who are some of these influencers they've got? Man, how forgettable are TikTokers? I can't remember any. Did they get Charli D'Amelio on there?
I think so.
Actually?
I don't. It doesn't. It just says they've got,
No way.
They've got quite a few, actually.
There's no way they got Charli D'Amelio. Okay, I take it all back. This is fucking bullshit. What are they doing?
They're literally just gathering a
read some names.
Well, they got Khalil Green, for example.
Okay.
It's literally the only name they've listed.
Find an article. Say, I want to know who they talk to, all right? There's no way they talk to the fucking D'Amelio family. They shouldn't, all right? Even if, right, let's say you did have the actual facts, the actual non-biased facts, don't give them to Charli D'Amelio, all right? Because anything that comes out of her mouth, I will not believe, you know? If Charli D'Amelio told me that Putin was invading Ukraine and committing war crimes, I would go, well, obviously I need to be pro-Russia, you know? If anything she says, I have to believe the opposite of. I'm sorry, Ukrainians, but, you know, I'm sure you would too. If Charli D'Amelio told you that Putin is invading your country to destroy it, you would rise up against your own government and join Russia. Let's be real.
But no, they've got, there's no list here that I can see, but they've got one named Ellie Zeeler.
Right. I think they talk to a bunch of news influencers.
Yeah. Neil Green.
Yeah. Okay. There's one girl that I actually follow that they talk to, this girl called Jules Turpak. She's fucking sick, actually, on TikTok. Her videos are really cool, really great, real snappy, very good. I've talked to her a couple of times, and she's sick. She actually talked about being talked to, and it seems like she had a really good take on it, which I think is the correct take, which is you can't, like, talking to influencers isn't enough, you know? Like, misinformation isn't getting out because influencers are saying the wrong thing, especially on TikTok, because TikTok is so powerful. The algorithm is so fucking powerful that you can create an account, upload a video, and if it's good enough or crazy enough or is enough of a hot take, you can bang 20 million views like that, like nothing. Like, literally anyone can do it. TikTok is such a powerful fucking app where if you put a video up that it knows people will like, it's going to deliver it to them. It doesn't really give a fuck. If you have a lot of followers, your stuff is more likely to bang. Like, the more followers that I get on the platform, I have noticed that my, like, minimum amount of views is going up. But it, like, if I upload a shit video, it's not going to travel. If I upload a great video, it's going to go as well as it probably would regardless of how many followers I have. Like, a truly viral TikTok video for me, I uploaded something that got 4 million views. That's when my account was, like, half the size. I'm not going to see those views until I get the next viral one. And I don't know. I feel like I could upload that one with 4 mil onto a brand new account and it would do similar numbers. Like, that's the real problem that, you know, people with the truth are going to face is it's not really influencers that are spreading misinformation. Like, they're not exactly the driving force behind it. Misinformation. If you really look at, like, the big influences from, you know, the extreme left, right, or just conspiracy theorists in general, you kind of notice that not many of them have invented any of these theories. They've just kind of attached themselves to already existing theories. Great example, QAnon. Who's that? We don't know. No one created that. That was like an organic thing created on the internet by internet users, and then it got out of hand, right? And then other people started attaching themselves to that, and then they kind of rose with the theory. I don't think, like, you know, like Alex Jones, you know, love him or hate him, he said a lot of true things, he said a lot of obviously false things. That guy was, I feel, like the last dude who could kind of create a theory out of thin air and make it disseminate across social media. That doesn't really happen anymore. Like, you don't really see, like, all these influencers they talk to, sure, they can put out the truth or America's version of the truth. It's not going to sway people as much as you would like. You know, it's not mainstream media. I think that's what the government's coming up against is the government before, governments of any nation, right? They could go, hey, news, say this. And we've seen it. The news will come out and fucking 50,000 different news anchors will read the same script. And then that becomes the truth. And then that becomes what people believe. And then that defines the culture of a country. And then that's what moves history, right? But now you can't do that anymore, because what you can do is you can tell the news to say it. But then everyone on social media will notice, hey, it seems like all these news readers are saying the exact same thing. That's a little bit fishy. Maybe that's not true. And then even if it is true, you're still going to get all these conspiracy theories spread by people who are like micro-influencers or just regular guys with like a charismatic take or a compelling take, or like they found like a nugget of truth in their argument or a nugget of lie in yours, and then it spreads like wildfire and it's almost impossible to contain. And it's not like you can, like you know, if the COVID's not real thing, right? You can't just go and talk to a bunch of really famous social media influencers, get them to post that COVID is real. It doesn't work like that, right? You need to make the information, if you really want to fight misinformation, you need to make the truth as accessible, as clear, and as transparent as possible, including the stuff that you're unsure about. Because that's how you find the truth. Like, if you tell people shit, like, oh, this is 100% true, and you're not sure of it, and then people find the bits that you're not sure about or maybe lied about, that's when they go, oh, well, all of it's not true, and you're fucking crazy, and I've got the real news. That's how it gets out there. If governments kind of came out, like, I think they could have, like, COVID is probably a better example. How they could have done it better is they could have gone, we know these things for sure, we're unsure about these things. And I don't think they did that. They came out and they were like, this is true, and this is true, and this is true. And then as science developed and found out more information about, you know, methods that they said didn't work, like in Australia, they were like, don't wear masks. And they were like, actually do wear masks. And then they were like, actually don't. And then they were like, oh, it's on surfaces. Actually, it's not. Actually, it is. Right? What they should have said is they should have gone, so we think maybe it could live on surfaces, so for now, let's try this, but we're not sure. We think masks work for now, but until we're sure, let's better safe than sorry. I feel like if they came a little bit more honestly like that, you would see a lot less arguing about whether or not you should wear a mask, whether or not it's on surfaces, whether or not the vaccine, you know, all that kind of bullshit. If they were just a bit more honest and were like, at the moment, our hypothesis is this. Can we please all do this for now until we work out if it's true and then you let us know? And I feel like, yeah, just more honesty is how you're actually going to fight misinformation, because instead you have like governments coming in and go, you got to do these things. And then a week later they go, actually, no. Or the opposite. You shouldn't do this. Actually, you should. And then it's like, well, how do I trust you then? If you told me a thing with absolute certainty and then it changed, did you know for sure? Or did you tell me something that you thought was true? Or did you just lie? Or which one's the truth now? It's easy to see how people can get confused. And also then just decide, well, it's all bullshit. I'm going conspiracy theory mode. So that's, I think, like what the problem that the government's coming up against with misinformation is that there's no real source of it. You know, it's just a bunch of people repeating a bunch of stuff that they emotionally connected with. And then it gets out of hand. And who cares who came up with it? It doesn't even matter. So having famous people or well-known influencers or trusted influencers speaking it, and also I just feel like inviting influencers to be briefed on shit is... So I see that and I go, oh, that's propaganda that they want these influencers to post. Because, I don't know, that. But I'm a bit of a distrustful person. But I think everyone has become more distrustful recently because of all this shit. So, yeah, the only way to truly control the narrative is to do what Russia has done, which is you black out social media, you own all of the mainstream media, and you tell them what to say, and then they tell the people what to think. And then, you know, if the only information you're seeing is this thing is true, it's true, you know? Like, truth truly becomes subjective when you're living in an environment, becomes objective when you live in an environment like that. And that's kind of what, it's the two opposites that you see. Like, in Russia, the truth is objective, right? This is what it is, and anyone who tells you otherwise goes to prison, and this is what it is. And then you only see the truth, so you believe it, and that's fucking true, and there's no nuance. Or you have the opposite, which is what we have, which is truth is subjective. Like, we've entered, like, this subjective truth world where, you know, for one group, this is the truth. But for that group, this is the truth. And there's not really much honest discussion. So everyone just prefers to go, that group's crazy. We know what's really going on. But I think to close off this thought, the main thing we should all take away from this is buy tickets at loosebeers.com for my Melbourne Comedy Festival shows. I'm going to end it there. Thank you very much. That's the end of the podcast. I don't have any emails. Send through your emails, podcast@loosebeers.com. If you need some life advice, if you have a story you would like me to hear, if you have a question for me, email me at podcast@loosebeers.com. Running low on emails, so if you send something through, we'll definitely read it, and you might get on the show. So let me know if you want to be anonymous. And yeah, thank you very much. I will talk to you guys on the Patreon version, which is going to continue right now. But yeah, I'll see you next week at the shows. It's going to be sick. Friday, Saturday, the first two shows, they're filling up now, so get your tickets. All right, see ya. Hope you have a shit one. Bye.